celebration of the life of a guy who, in many ways, and to many of us, was really large in life. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dave Evans, and I'll be your master of ceremony for that this afternoon. And I've had the fortune, the good fortune, of being a friend and sometimes associate of Frank's for almost 50 years. Our association began around 1972 or 1973 when I managed to scam a free haircut ticket from one of my teammates on the Vancouver Arts Lacrosse Club. And I made the trek from the safe confines of my home in North Burnaby to the wilds of South Burnaby and Kingsway in particular. I went to Kirby's Unisex Salon for my first haircut under the guidance of Frank. And it must have been a good one because I kept going back for the next 40, almost 50 years, as I say. It got to the point where I could go into Frank's shop or over the last little while into his basement. Frank would say, "Well, what can we do for you, Dave?" I said, "How do your fingers bleed?" It was sort of like Norm going into Cheers. "Norm!" When he was Dave. "What can I do for you?" "How do your fingers bleed?" Later on, I had the somewhat good fortune, I suppose, of being conned into coaching the team that Frank had sponsored, a women's lacrosse team that Frank sponsored. This was back in 1978. Frank and I were together with that team for 4 years, I guess. And then later on, Frank was the general manager. I was the coach of the North Shore Indians and the Western Lacrosse Association. And since then, along with lowering my ears, we've become very good friends and spent many long evenings in various establishments under various amounts of adult beverages solving the woes of lacrosse and of the world. Now, when I first heard of Frank's passing 1 month ago today, after the shock, but certainly the first the shock and the sorrow wore off a little bit, I started thinking about today, the memorial, the celebration of life, and what a diverse group of people are going to be here. And we've got hairstylists, we've got barbers, we've got bikers, we've got jocks from all various walks of life. We've got a bunch of people who just got their hair cut. Because Frank was a diverse person. He had many, many interests, and he had many, many, as you shall see, influences throughout his life. Some of you here, his family, knew him as a brother, or as Uncle Frank. Others knew him as an employer, and as a mentor. Others as a club associate, and a racetrack regular. To some of us, he was a sponsor, a manager, and a non-stop volunteer. And to some, he was just that guy who cut your hair and shared some laughs. But to everyone here, Frank was a loyal friend, and that's how everyone of us here remembers him, and will continue to remember him as time goes on. Now, Frank grew up and attended school in Burnaby. Went to barbering school. It was barbering school back then. They all got snotty and became hairdressers later on. But he went to hairdressing school and began his barbering career in 1961 before opening his own shop, the legendary Kirby's Unisex up on Kingsway in Gillay in 1969. Now someone who's truly known Frank all his life, partially because he had no choice, I'd like to introduce Frank's brother, Fred, to say a few words.
Fred? Oh, well.
Touched so many people during his time here in Brooks. As I said,
Today, as I reach out for the right words to express my thoughts about my brother Frank, I remember the many valued and meaningful roles that Frank played throughout his life. First and foremost, I see him as a family man. He was a devoted husband, uncle, brother, friend. And looking back, he was a family man. Frank was a comfort to my mom and dad when they were with us. I always knew he was there watching over them. He was a very respectful, caring man. Frank took out all the roles of life to heart and strove to honor and support and guide, and most importantly, protected his family. He was at his happiest when he was surrounded by his family and during the eventful tough times that life has a way of throwing at you. He devoted to the family was the foundation of his actions. The anchor that was defined in life. As I turn to this next page, I think of Frank's life, I see Frank a friend. He was a good friend to so many. He could be counted on and depended on as of always. Whether he needed a simple advice, a sympathetic ear, a shoulder to lean on, a listener, if you will, all he wanted was to pass the time. He was a man ready, steadfast, dwelling on good front. Look out for this gathering, and I see many friends, and family and friends, I know that you too will miss the friendship that Frank brought in your lives. I'm sure you all remember Frank in a very own special way. As I continue to turn the pages of Frank's life, I see Frank, a man defiant and willing to settle for less. Frank lived a principled life by strong sense of right and wrong. Frank was a cruel man, was not a cruel man, and he wanted people to understand that nothing can be gained from his holding a grudge or leaving an issue that was very wrong or unclear. He spoke up with it. When really counted, his strong principles did not allow him to let something wrong stand unchallenged. Frank cared enough to act and follow through. He never let anyone or anything stand in his way of making things right. He can only imagine how much more he accomplished with life would come for his illness. Another page turned and I see a respected citizen who shared this expertise and with anyone who would listen. He worked hard and consistently and remained a student of life. Frank never sat back and became complacent. He led the way by example as he mentored his nephews and nieces in a way any one of them could say they were inspiration in their lives. My brother Frank was a businessman and saw opportunity and made the most of it. One could say that what he touched turned to gold because he had a vision and a vision prompted him to act. Frank, by the same token, was not proud that he turned to his family for advice and he knew there were heads in it. Two or three heads were better than one. As I turned the page again, I come face to face with Frank, a man of passion and a dedicated supporter. He remained a keen sportsman who loved lacrosse, car racing, and along with motorcycles. Frank supported life, sports through his business, encouraged others to do the same. I know if he was given a chance, he would have become a dedicated athlete. I am so grateful I was able to spend time with Frank prior to his passing. There was no other way I wanted to remember him than this way. Frank, brother, it was very hard to say goodbye, so we will just say so long. The pages of your book will never be closed, just as the pages of mom and dad are not closed either. We will remember you through the many people still left behind. Their lives are so positive. You may not realize, but you leave an amazing legacy behind. Frank, brother, we will miss you, but we will always remember you with respect, admiration, love. May you rest in peace, Frank Krueger.
Most of you at some point in time went into Kirby's Unisex Salon on Kingsway. And what a beehive that place was. Two floors of stylists, shampoo people, four sweepers, and heaven knows what else running around, all under the guidance of Frank Kirby. And I think to the people that worked at, or under Frank, at Kirby's, not only at the Unisex Salon, but at other places after that, he was more than a boss. He was a mentor. And he was a man who guided stylists and potential business people along the way, so that many of them branched out, opened their own shops, in competition for Frank's, but with his full support, and that really speaks highly of the man. I'd like to introduce one of those employees from Kirby's Unisex Salon to come forward now and speak, I suppose, on behalf of the many people that worked there through the years. Lisa Coy, please come forward.
Challenge for calling weeks to be the highest earner. It was fallen here, as in those days in the 80s, can't say anything. I have to acknowledge the sponsorship that Frank did and has insisted on all of our staff. Steamers, the Clippers, the food bank, the sponsorship drives that we all were accountable to support, which was amazing. Lanthorn Baseball at Central Park, the beer gardens, the kids' races. Frank actually would bring in a concession stand. I think they're called food trucks today. Frank is pioneering a lot of things. I don't know if any of you were at kids' days. I know I was doing the three-legged race at the day of Sack and various other races to entertain the children while the guys were all playing ball and the moms were all drinking beer and spinning ball. Also, all the kids' sports, women, hockey, lacrosse, all of the sports that he photoed, which we all knew on the salon walls were back to front covered with photos. Another very special memory in my house with memory with Frank was Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve was a really busy day at Kirby's, and it was funny because drinks were flowing for everybody except us. We worked until 4 o'clock. And then he had our staff party to join the fun, and it would go to all hours. How fun was that? Frank also had a very interesting sidebar businesses that we ran as well. For instance, we all learned how to cut keys. Yep. The travel agency, and boy, did the Outrigger West do well, as we all visited it. I think one of the funniest things as well, I think today is called SodaStream. Back in the 80s, Frank brought in a carbonation unit in the staff room, and we all learned how to make pop. But not like Pepsi. So many histories, so many memories. Frank was actually the MC at my wedding. Thirty years ago. He always had a sense of humor. He picked us up from the church, and I'll never forget getting in the back of that brown sedan. And I looked at him, and I said, "Frank, are you kidding me? Do I need to drive?" And he had it covered to clean the car we went, and to the reception. He prepared an amazing slideshow. Do you remember? Slides. Which he dropped. But it was all in good fun. Frank, thank you. For your direction. 6 weeks ago, when you were sitting in my chair, and I was cutting your hair, and you made me laugh. Because I asked you, "How are you feeling, Frank?" And he said, very humorously, "I don't know. I can't remember." They keep telling me that I had a stroke, but they tell me something's wrong, but can't remember what it is. Humor, right to hear. I love that man. Anyways, I would like toast to Mike. And may you have as many Pepsis as you want.
Somehow, Frank or somebody else close to Frank had arranged for this great summer house. All the people that lived in Long Beach left for the family. I don't want to lie, but they left. I think it was somewhere around 2,000 motorcycles at that time. From all over the states, I think we were about the only club in Canada. And we have a super team. The only problem was is that I loaded my trusty Triumph off the trailer, and a piece of crap wouldn't start the whole thing. I got rid of it as soon as I got back. Then we had another run that Frank planned for us. We met out at the old orchard again. Frank was just saying, go on the squirrels race in Camels. So we hit it off. We got up in the middle of Madison Park and the sky opened up and it was pouring rain. So we pulled into a construction site. Flipped the bike trailer upside down. A couple of guys were sleeping under that. There were six guys in my car. Everybody else was huddled up underneath the bridge. So a couple of the guys decided, let's let the camp car at least keep me warm. About an hour and a half later, we had leaving because we set up a fire as we were going to the bridge house and we left town. We got out of campus. It was a great ride after that. The next morning, we cleared up. We pulled into this site where the scramble races are out in the mountains. There's not a soul there. This is Sunday morning when we got there. So we, one of the guys back down the highway, pulled into the gas station and said, hey, what's up with the scramble races? Oh, shit, that was last weekend. Frank had a great morning. But he was just, he treated us all like brothers. We treated him like a brother. And it's just beyond me, the friendship that's created through the years right up until today. In 1976, the club became an active, but the bonds was formed. And a few years later, Tommy Stephen, who was the last president of the club, had a get together at his house with a few of the members. Frank was there. And it was great to see old faces, and a few of the guys who always kept in touch with us, but a few wondered where they were and how they were doing. Well, after that little reunion, Frank took it on. The next thing you know, we had a huge sheet of paper with all the members' names, email addresses, phone numbers. So they could start contacting people they hadn't seen for years. And then it just grew and grew and grew. And today, it's as strong a brotherhood as it ever was. We've lost a lot of great people, a lot of great friends, but above all, we lost our gear. And then it hurts us down deep. The only saving grace of all of this is that Frank's legacy will live on as long as we do. And that's going to be years to come, because I know my son loves Frank as much as I do, and he'll carry the legacy on with me. But that has to say,
thanks, Frank.
Thank you, Frank, for all the memories, all the fun, and we'll never forget. Just thinking as Dave was talking, those 2,000 mice coming into town might have something to do with everybody being in town. Just Dave. Anyway, I mentioned listening to Frank talking about his trip to Sturgis and something Dave mentioned in there about his honeymoon. Talking to Zaya last night when we were going over the program, she mentioned that in 2000, when they were married, Sturgis was the trip that was their honeymoon trip. So things do happen in twos. I think, I guess that spells romance to some people, maybe not to everybody. But Frank's passion for motorcycles and for everything on wheels was undeniable. One of the other things that was undeniable was the contributions Frank made to various communities, mostly Berkeley, through his actions as a sponsor.
You know, when I talked earlier in the afternoon about the various things Frank was, a mentor and everything and so forth, never mentioned athlete. Matter of fact, I never saw Frank in a pair of shorts. I was shocked, actually. I saw a picture last night that I showed me on one of their trips to Hawaii. And I thought, oh, fucker, Frank's got legs. Amazing. He actually had shorts on. But through Frank's dedication, through his hard work, through his commitment, through his sponsorship efforts, so many athletes were allowed to fulfill their dreams. And for that, on behalf of all of these athletes, I thank him so much. He sponsored virtually all sports: auto racing, lacrosse, hockey, soccer, basketball, volleyball, baseball, fastball. But when Frank was your sponsor, he was never simply a sponsor. He was your manager, he was your water boy, sometimes he was your coach when nobody else could do it, and he was always your number one fan. In fact, in 1988, Frank received a certificate of merit from the Government of Canada in recognition of his contributions to his community through those sponsorship efforts. Now, obviously, we can't have every one of those teams represented here today, but we are going to have some memories shared from representatives of some of the teams and activities that Frank sponsored. So I'd first like to introduce a guy that does double duty here. Played for both Frank's Clippers lacrosse team and his men's hockey team, Mark Benson. Mark. Thank you. I first met Frank Kirby in the mid-70s after I finished my minor lacrosse career in New Westminster and was recruited to play for Kirby's Clippers Senior B lacrosse team. Frank was always the promoter. He sold cold beer and cold cups in between periods in the spare dressing room. And there was an awful lot of fans in the stands drinking from big gold cups at our Saturday night home games at Burnaby Lake Arena. Frank was always figuring out ways to promote the Senior B lacrosse team. One of his greatest ideas of all times was the creation of the masked man, Mr. X, and his sidekick, Mad Dog Smith. Mr. X's identity was top secret, and we were all sworn to secrecy. Mr. X and Mad Dog were like a tag team, and cast fear into opponents throughout the league. Many a brawl broke out, and when they did, Mr. X and Mad Dog beat up their opponents like something out of All-Star Wrestling. The fans ate it up. Years later, Frank and Fred sponsored our ice hockey team in the Royal City Hockey League. Frank was very instrumental in starting women's lacrosse and sponsoring women's ice hockey in the mid-70s. Today, there are hundreds of women's teams playing both ice hockey and lacrosse in the Lower Mainland and the rest of British Columbia. Frank also used to rent a hall, an order hall, on Canada Way, and book A-circuit bands, and get his women's team to sell tickets and volunteer at some legendary dances. Frank Kirby was one of the most generous, kindest men I ever met. He would give you the shirt off his back, and he was the type of guy that always had your back. He will be truly missed, but never forgotten. Rest in peace, my friend. For those of you who aren't, for lack of a better term, lacrosse people, or aren't old enough to remember those days in the mid to late 70s, I was playing senior lacrosse at the time, and Kirby Slippers were a phenom. Saturday night at the old rink. The old Burnaby Arena was, for lack of a better term, must-see TV. I mean, how many of us can forget seeing Frank and his El Camino driving around Burnaby and everywhere else with a big sign in the back? Clippers lacrosse, Burnaby Arena, Saturday night, 8 o'clock. Along with various sales at the salon, or when all else fails, we fix $10 haircuts. It's kind of ironic that we're holding this memorial in a Burnaby facility and talking about how we ran a bar with a spare dressing room at Burnaby Lake Arena and the amazing parties and dances that went on back in the old Sons of Norway Hall. But that was Frank. One thing with Frank, he played for his team, as I say. He was your number one fan. He was also your number one party organizer. Now, as mentioned, Frank loved anything on wheels. So I'd now like to introduce a couple of guys, one at a time. We knew him as a sponsor of his famous number 75 car at both Langley Speedway and later at Skagit Speedway in the States throughout the 80s and into the early 90s. First, I'd like to introduce Fred Ranner, who was a track announcer at Langley Speedway and established a bond with Frank that's carried on into the lacrosse world and carried on to Frank's passing. Fred?
Thanks, Dave. Great to see so many familiar faces. Yeah, how times have changed, huh? Now you go into these arenas, they got signs up, no alcohol in the dressing room, signs outside the building, no tailgating. Ah, yes, how times have changed. And how fitting that we're here today in a hockey lacrosse arena. Some of my most recent memories of Frank apart from the racetrack, we're seeing him sit right up there as game commissioner on Friday nights for the WLA games here with the Burnaby Lakers. So, yeah, real fitting that we're here. Dave, I was just thinking, as you were speaking, I wouldn't know you if it wasn't for Frank. As you said, I knew Frank through auto racing, announcing Langley Speedway, Skagit Speedway, Capacity Speedway on the island, where Frank was part owner. So he knew me for that, as well as my hockey announcing. But then he needed an announcer for North Radiant, where Dave was the head coach. So don't mind me, a couple of nights of auto racing announcing, and about 2 hours of sleep last night. That's the voice. Anyway, so I got to tell you about this first game. So I come in, done hockey, done auto racing, so like, okay, lacrosse isn't going to be too big a difference, especially from hockey. Anyway, so we get there, get my notes together, and my first announcement of the game. And Dave, actually, I think this might have been your fault. North Shorty's penalty, bench Niner penalty, too many men. Remember, this is lacrosse, not hockey. I say penalty, too many men on the ice. On the ice, or lacrosse. That was my, I'm not kidding you, before any goals or penalties that night, was the first announcement, I don't know if you remember. Anyway, as I say, used to hockey, we scored 2-1, 3-2, whatever. I think the final score that was tonight was like 15-13, 14-12. There was a ton of penalties, like 200 minutes of penalties. I was way behind on the announcements. Ended in a big brawl as well at the end of the night. I think there was still time left on the clock when the game was called. So it was pretty crazy. I'll never forget going out to see Frank in the dressing room after the game. I said, man, this is just unbelievable compared to what I mean, fights and goals a mile a minute. Is it always like this? She said, yeah, pretty much. Want a beer? But that was quite the introduction to lacrosse, and all these years later, I guess, what we find, still involved in that as well. But as I say, and as Frank said, Fletcher Roy Blumenhagen, who will speak next, the familiar red, black, and white number 75, the original stock car of Langley Speedway, and then got its gadget into the sprint cars, and as I say, Cassidy Speedway, where Frank was part owner on Vancouver Island as well. And right up until this year, Frank was still a sponsor of Billy Beasley's stock car out at Agassiz Speedway. And I saw Frank out there, not this year, but numerous times last year. And just such great memories. Two things, though, I think that I would remember the most that stand out in my mind about Frank. First of all, the number of people that he met in his life. I mean, my goodness, do you know anybody that knew more people than Frank Kirby? You just think cutting hair alone for what, it's over 50 years. Just cutting hair alone, forget about all the sports and the motorcycle trips, the almost 100 trips, I guess, to Hawaii, that might be some kind of record, and the trip to Sturgis. It's just phenomenal. And you see him one night at a kids lacrosse game or a kids hockey game anywhere around the lower mainland, you know, with maybe 50 or 100 people there. And then the next night, you see him at a big time event, across lines, stealth game, and no matter where you went, he knew people and he was surrounded by people. He touched on it. People just gravitated to him. Because he just had that kind of personality. So the number of people he knew, that's the one thing. And the other thing was, you know, the old saying, you don't judge a book by its cover. And you maybe throw Fred into the mix as well with Frank. Especially when I was younger, and I know I've heard this from other people as well. They seem like a couple of pretty intimidating guys when you first run into them. The long hair, the beard, the tattoos, hanging around guys with leather jackets, and, you know, big tough guys. And at first you think, oh boy, what am I getting myself into? But then, as so many of the speakers have alluded to already today, you couldn't find somebody with a bigger heart, so kind, all the charities that he donated to. And it's one thing to have I don't know, I never really saw Frank angry or mad, yelling and screaming. And that might not be out of the ordinary if you're into stamp collecting or coin collecting or checkers and chess. But when you're involved in pretty intense sports, like hockey, lacrosse, and auto racing, that is, it's pretty amazing. There's just a number of controversies. Sometimes. Yeah, those would be the two things that I remember most about him. The number of people he met, and as I say, was just what a nice man, was just such a calm demeanor. You might be all fired up about something that just happened at a race or a sporting event, but he calmed me down, and this story I'm going to tell is a perfect example of it. So as I say, Frank and Fred, they were co-owners of Cassidy Speedway, dirt oval track just south of Nanaimo. And Roy would race there once in a while with a sprint car. So right off the bat, it's a bit of a touchy situation. You're part owner of the racetrack, but you got a horse in the race, but car in the race as well. So Roy, I think you know this, one of the first Cassidy Cups, September, probably early 1990s. And we got a big crowd there. And we've got a lot of big name drivers from the States, from Alberta. Here's Roy Blumenhagen with his underfunded, underpowered, I believe 327 cubic inch car that night against 360 cubic inch cars, 410 power cars, and as we say, a lot of big names. Anyway, Roy finds himself leading the race late in the race. So I'm announcing it. And of course, I'm getting the crowd wound up. This is kind of a Cinderella story, you might say. Could he pull it off? It would be the biggest win of his career. He's leading the race late. And on the last corner of the last lap, I'm not going to say the name, but one of the big names from Washington State, he basically takes Roy out in the last corner of the last lap. Well, now Frank, as part owner of the track, He could have come into the situation and told his officials to disqualify this guy and maybe even credit the win to Roy. But Frank did not want to create any kind of potential conflict of interest. He has officials doing their job, and he was part owner of the track, but he was going to stay away from the officials' decision. And that was not an easy thing to do. So anyway, in the meantime, this other guy pulls into the winner's circle. The fans are livid. I can see the beer cans and pop cans coming out of the grandstand. Roy's pretty mild-mannered guy. He was pretty fired up. His pit crew comes around and I say, Frank, you better do something here pretty quick. And he said, Frank, don't worry about it. This is actually good. This is good for business right now. No kidding. You're right there up there with me. And Dave, you've probably seen it before in the lacrosse area. Same thing after a controversial goal, overtime. But so anyway, our potential powder keg. Fred, you were there. You remember this. It's getting potential real trouble here. So, as I say, stuff's flying onto the track. Fans are trying to get down on the track. Crews are running towards the winner's circle. And there's some profanity flying. There's a little pushing and shoving. And then Frank sends in the troops. Not to add more trouble, to calm everything down, just like Frank would. And he had a lot of troops, you know that. He had guys who would get in there, and there was a little push and shoving, there was a lot of yelling and screaming. But Roy, again, you remember, and it was great for business. The next night, biggest crowd of the year. So that's just a perfect example of what he and Roy might have lost by not winning that race. They gained probably tenfold the next night with a big crowd and just adding so much more interest to this racetrack and what we do. But it's been really great listening to all the stories. Everybody's got a different story, and sometimes these things drag on a little bit, but I'll tell you, I've been just riveted by all the speeches. They've all done a great job, and it's just so interesting. As I say, such a diverse life and such a variety of memories and people. So there is a big lacrosse game, I know, tonight, later on, Dave. So I better round this up. A lot of people will be heading out to Maple Ridge later on tonight. But again, thanks for everything, Frank. Thanks for the memories. Gonna miss you.
Thanks, Fred. I'm going to say that too many men on the floor penalty was whoever was running the gate's fault. Not on me. Anyway, as Fred mentioned, I mentioned earlier, Frank sponsored that 75 car. But hey, somebody had to drive it. We're fortunate to have Roy Bloom and Hayden here up in the States, who drove Frank's vehicle, pulled that landing in Skagit, come forward and say a few words about his old sponsor.
Another month or so, I'll give you another 250. That's where it started. So I raised 2 years of money with the stock market and my colors. I got married to my first wife, and I wanted to get a sprint car. My dad said, you need to get a sprint car, it's going to help you. Forget it. We'll see 15 inches, you can't drive. I'm like, not whatever, Dad. So I asked Frank to come with me. Let's go look at the first sprint car, you know? It was Jane Coleman's car down in Cedar Woolley. So we get to the border, and Frank and I mean, Harris is with this purplish Mac coat, you know, the rough jeans and tough-looking guy who's doing some things in the way of driver's seat, driving a little shit at four-door. So we get to the border, and the guy says, where are you guys going? We're going to look at Frank's car. How about you two know each other? He says, well, this is my car. Frank looks over and says, I cut his hair. Okay, that was off we went. We're 30 seconds down the road. And Frank's like, I'd like to come through the border to you. Sure, it was a little rough to get through the border. From that point on, I went through the border. I was always the driver. So I ran that car for 5 races at Skagit. Sold the car, it couldn't get any more. It was too expensive. And that car, initially, was I went with black, and my friend Frank liked the color black. So I had this little 1-inch strip of red, and a little half-inch strip of silver and white. The color problem I came up with. So right here, adding a little more red, because I like red. So as you can see by the coats and stuff, I stayed with this coat. I'm pretty proud of that. So Frank's job at the shop, when we worked at the shop, we worked on the race car a lot together. I gave him things to do, because it was the only time he had and stuff. So his jobs were to do the spark plugs, do the nozzles, change the oil. We did that every week. I worked a lot, real hard on the car. We did a lot of fun things together. I taught a lot, he taught me a lot. He was into the promotion part of it. They did his truck the same colors. It was just really cool what he did for me. He went to parades. We met a lot of people. If it wasn't for him, I mean, he just did a lot for me. It was really cool. I really appreciate that. There was one guy who had a crew. I guess I won't mention his name, but he was a little slow. He was a kid. We're working in the back of the shop one day. We're trying to save some money. I'm trying to give this guy something to do. So I had a front tire. And left arm's not good at that work. It's sprint cars. So I said, well, I'm going to need to do there. So I sent this young man around the back corner of Frank's house. We couldn't see him, but he'll be okay. So he put maybe 5 pounds in there and give it to you. To find a hole. Well, anybody knows, in an interview call myself, you can't get 5 pounds of air. You'll never get 5 pounds of air because there's no pressure on the tire. So, Frank says, you know, it's kind of quiet back there. We went back around the corner. Frank's like, whoa, what's going on back here? We look, and there's this massive riverbed tumbling back around the tire. And there's this big hole, and he goes, I can't get 5 pounds of air in this tire. I found the hole. On the way to the meet, we had a lot of people. We got to meet Skagit, and we bring our Canadian beer down. And Frank got tired of spending all this Canadian beer, so we go all stop at this little store in Algiers, just down the road by my house right now. So just get some of that shit beer, and we take it out of the second letter, and we'll tell them what it is. So it's really cheap beer. So we put that in there, and we got our beer, and he says, anybody comes up after the races and wants a beer? You didn't want to know. Well, we did one for ourselves. Sure enough, you did that. It worked out great. So as the years went on, it was time to sell the car. And, we had a good 12 years. We had a lot of fun with that spring car. It just got to be expensive. I just didn't want to spend a lot of Frank's money, so I really budgeted. I think I crashed maybe five times in all years of racing. And that's pretty good. Just save wings, save this. Let's take the tire, flip it around, and use it one more time. And I got to see these get expensive. So he sold the car. I helped him sell it. I
I bought the trailer, I bought leftover parts, and I sold some stuff to Swami. And I continued racing on my own with my dad as the years went on. So, we were okay with that. Still good friends. I got back, I think it was 7 years after my I got married, my second wife. I moved to the United States, and I bought another race car. And I said to Frank, I said, I'm not going to sponsor you anymore, and that's okay. I said, but I got a leftover Christmas tree. Would you mind if I put it on the car just to buy money for 1 week? So, I did. Last time I saw Frank was at AC Speedway 2 years ago. I heard he had an engine race car and I was going to come watch him race. So I went to the track. Almost turned, got to take it into that Speedway. Awful. I think they get lost. So I made it there and I went on the stands. And I figured Frank would be in pits. I had no idea where he'd be. So I'm walking him. Frank's announcing. Frank, come on, he's in the middle of the thing. Man stands up. Frank Kirby. So we sat together all night and talked about racing. It was kind of nice to see him 2 years ago. And after we left, I said, Frank, I really don't think I can find my way out of here in the dark. A lot of turns. And he said, no, I know it's going around. So he said, just follow us. And before I left, I gave him a big old hug. I said, it's good to see you again, Frank. Frank's not much for hugs, but it was okay. I think he was like, oh, all right. I just went with it. So, that's pretty much what I have to say about Frank. And thanks for all the memories, my friend. Thank you.
Back in the, I guess, late 70s, I used to live on Patterson in Burnaby. Right across the street from Central Park. And quite often, Saturday, Sunday afternoons, I sit on my balcony, because there'd be a ball game going on across the street. And surprisingly enough, there was Frank and the Alcamino and the big sign in the back. Instead of Clippers lacrosse, it was Steamers ball. And it just looked like a party going on, and a ball game happened to break out. And that was the Steamers. Fastball? I can get a hold of myself. Yeah, fastball. They're all baseball to me. Fastball team that Frank sponsored for a long time. And like most of his teams, long successful years. I'd like to ask Rick Lyons, who's a part of that Steamers organization / team, to come up and say a few words on behalf of the Steamers. That entertained me so well on those Saturday, Sunday afternoons in Central Park.
Well, he took care of it. For those of you that do not know me, my name is Rick Lyons, and I'm a born and raised South Curry boy. The pleasure of knowing Frank Kirby for 45 years or more. Firstly, he was my barber for most of my life. I was also lucky enough to play fastball for the now legendary Curdy's Nine Coil Steamers for many years. The old Central Park fastball community may remember me as Catman, the nickname bestowed upon me by the team. But believe me, it could have been a whole lot worse. There was no opposing pitcher in our league that had been christened Cat Piss by the Steamers. Poor Robbie, destined to be known as Cat Piss from that day forward. Has to be one of my favorite nicknames ever, and just really grateful it wasn't pinned on me. Feel quite honored if I asked you to say a few words today. Must admit I was a bit hesitant at first, and good to be standing in front of half of the population of Guernsey. Some of the daunting tasks that came with a heavy dose of trepidation on my part. There's also one more problem. I'm definitely not a man of few words. But my understanding is that the gathering is scheduled for about 4 hours. Anyway, we're all here today to pay our respects on the passing of a colorful, larger-than-life character that was admired and loved by many. Frank was a highly intelligent, witty person with many positive attributes, not the least being a terrific sense of humor.
Kirk enjoyed it a lot, as much as anyone I've ever met. That's why I asked you to suffer through a few of my lame attempts at humor. Frank would be pleased in knowing that every hero loves the smiles and laughter to outweigh the sorrow of his passing. So let's do our best to make this a true celebration of life, the life of someone special to a whole lot of people, Frank Kirby. You must be suffering a deep and powerful hurt, Zach, and we all hope that the pain you're feeling will soon be overwhelmed by memories of the happy times and special moments you and Frank shared together as husband and wife. I'm sure that there were many. Well, I guess I should get started now. First time I saw Frank was probably in the early 70s. The memory of the exact time and place are a little hazy. Living through the 60s probably had that effect on a lot of people. I wasn't quite sure what to make of him at first. The look was certainly unique. My first impression was that he may have had aspirations to follow in the footsteps of Wolfman Jack. But Kirby was definitely not a follower. He blazed his way through life in signature fashion with much joy, energy, and unwavering purpose. When I first became a customer at his fish shop, Kingsway and Gilly, one of Kirby's girls always took care of my haircut. After a few visits, I began to notice how Frank always looked so sharp, neatly dressed, and freshly groomed at all times. It was kind of open a little bit of magic might rub off on me. I started booking my appointments with him. I was pretty impressed with the whole experience. Like it was a better barber on the planet. From then on, he became my go-to guy. I never looked so good.
This is a creepy call.
Luckily, he adhered to his policy of barbering from then on, making him a little more available. I followed him from Kingsway to Julie Avenue to Seating Wall, where he shared the shop with his old barber school buddy Mark. Finally, the street I set up in the basement of his longtime straight home. It was 3 years at Julie Lawley in his home studio that I got to know Frank pretty well. He didn't have 15 or 20 employees to oversee, as he did on Kingsway. The haircuts became a more personal one-on-one experience. It was the old style barbershop visit, in Lawley especially. The cut came with a heavy dose of twisted conversation and sarcasm. In other words, the BS got pretty thick. You get Frank stopping by just to sit and shoot the breeze. Despite my hair was often, my cape was often there to add a little color, or should I say, colorful commentary to the proceedings. The haircuts were always a positive and enjoyable experience. Frank was also my son Aaron's barber from the time he was no longer a moving target until the cut he received just a few weeks ago. Even though the barbershop visits were the only time they shared, Frank and Aaron developed a pretty strong relationship, largely because of the person Kirby was. He took a sincere interest in getting to know him, what his aspirations were going into the future, and what was happening in his life. I have to say that Frank was the epitome of what a people person should be. Whoa, rambled on and on and I haven't left the barbershop. He also had a huge impact on my life and the lives of many others by his sponsorship and tireless devotion pertaining to numerous local sports. He was instrumental in funding, organizing, and overseeing a variety of teams and leagues. Kirby's Clippers lacrosse team certainly provided him with some memorable and highly successful seasons. They were just one of many teams that did him proud. It was a common sight to see Kirby cruising around town in his black Alto Nino with a big billboard of a sign bolted down in the back. That was just one of his ways of getting the word out about his teams, venues, and game times. He was just a driving force in the building of a Pauly basketball league around the steam or Central Park. The band really grew to something bigger than any of us expected or imagined. Of course, Kirby was not the only sponsor expected of the teams in the league. There was Kenny Munchie, who built a small empire of selling sandwiches, the late night crowd that stumbled in from Delaney's Pub or the Wooden Barrel, or the Astor Hotel, where you could take a first date for a beer or a cocktail, and probably never ever see her again. Such a place. Well, anyways, I played baseball, taught hardball, so I was very from the little league years until I was 18 years old. At 19, I went to play at Queen's Park in New West.
It was high level ball, but my heart just wasn't in it. Where are all my buddies from South Germany? Not here. Decided it was time to walk away from what was probably my favorite sport. Soon after, I ran into Paul Douglas, also known as Paul Smut, going way back. I played a lot of baseball and soccer with him at Easton for years. He told me there was a softball team he had been playing on, suggested I should check out and perhaps join the team. That was my introduction to Kirby Steinfeld's Steamers. Thanks, Paul. Rest in peace. Certainly a much different environment from the ones I have become accustomed to. But the uniform was kind of though, this was a good shot university, just an orange t-shirt with Kirby's nine post steamers on the back. The logo had not been silkscreen or ink, but then ironed on, one black club felt letter at a time. It was a torquing equivalent of that old patch and blue product speed sole. Bells in the orange with these original steamers, Rangel, Catwalker buddies, and in the circle of friends, consisted of blue jeans and a pair of Aitons and cowboy boots. But there was something enjoyable and appealing about being around these guys. People like CEO, Ross Emble, Bob Scott, better known as Screw, and others. They knew how to have a good time, and there was never a dull moment. The first thing I played in with the steamers was the pause thing. It was the waning stages of the power power years, and teams were comprised of mostly West 4th Avenue hits. The results of games were actually posted in the Georgia State newspaper, so we must have really hit the big time. When the Steamers arrived for games, you can probably imagine the reaction of our opponents. Big, menacing, looking bearded men on harness. The word that would best describe the look on their faces was likely horrified. We finished the season as league champs, but I never heard anything more about the cause of the league we began. Maybe we fight them off, but they decided they would prefer to spend more time with our hookah pipes and black light poster rooms. In the years that followed, a lot of my close friends and people I'd gone out with came to play with the Steamers and other teams in the league. There were lots of great people from all over the city. That was the key factor in moving to Denver to get into its glory years. We were registered as C-ball, but weren't far off the level of Steam League. There were many players who could have moved up to higher leagues, but most stayed put. Even the most talented athletes realized that there were too many good times and too many competitive games to be had right where they were. I knew Kirby drew much pride and satisfaction from the success of the league, and he enjoyed every minute of it. Without him, it's quite likely that none of it would ever happen. As well as the evening games during the week, the league keeps your four games back to back, beginning at noon on Sundays. Back in those good old days, the law required all bars and liquor stores to be closed on Sundays. If you were organized and had the incentive, you could make a fistful of money on beer sales. Of course, Kirby was in there like a dirty shirt in his element, interacting with that terrific Kirby-based crowd, and making more than a few bucks on the side. He wasn't the only one leaving the park at days and with a lot of small bills. Perhaps that contributed to his ability to consistently maintain Mondays as a day away from work. Considering the less than adequate seating we our ball diamond had for fans, we drew some pretty impressive crowds.
The sunshine, free entertainment, and socializing were a big part of the appeal.
The call of a nice cold beer at $2 a pop was certainly a raring call. I think it says a lot about the people involved. Even though the beer was flowing freely, the problems were few and far between. We pretty much released ourselves, and the city pretty much left us alone. The reputation that Kirby had built for himself and the community was likely a factor as well. And even though he didn't have any of his own children involved, Frank even organized a kids' day once a year in the park, supplying treats and small deals with all the kids on hand. He put a lot of effort into making this a success. He was a thoughtful, big-hearted person in many ways. I certainly have some vivid memories of it down for a few years, and I'd like to share one of them with you now.
Try to contain your sleep.
The story revolves around a tree that's on the outskirts of our old diamond at Central Park. We weren't lucky enough to have an outfield fence, and the tree in question had a huge impact on one of our games.
The three of us right about was to hit a ball into the tree for the pivotal time in the game. Would have been a home run anywhere else in the field of play, but Lou, our most regular paid umpire, threw to the ground for a double. Of course, the receivers vehemently disagreed, and much whining, complaining, and general mayhem ensued. But Lou stood his ground, and we ended up losing the game. He called a pregame conference with the receivers and opponent before the next scheduled start. He wanted to reiterate the ground rules concerning the tree. He pointed to center field as he slowed, then suddenly went silent with the most confused and dumbfounded look on his face. The tree had mysteriously vanished. It was one of those moments when time stood still. It was seen that a little lumberjacking had recently taken place under cover of darkness. Lou was convinced it must have been Spiegel, but it was Paul Douglas, wielding a little steamer power by the light of the moon. Seems like a fairly logical solution now. Just don't get caught. It wasn't for clearly a lot of people will miss out. It wasn't very fun. It has set the life of the high infectious, and people seem to naturally gravitate towards them. Whatever project or venture you have been involved with, whether it was organizing a ride, putting together a sports team or league, tinkering with his motorcycles and cars, or venturing into auto racing, you never had an issue with finding people willing to jump on board. It was some work that knew children's involved, but I also knew that they would have an awesome time because they would be working alongside Caribbean friends. These are the things that gave very much joy in life, the projects and the hobbies, but even more so, the people. So I mentioned earlier, Frank was very much a people person. One of the steamers, Dickie Douglas, I think his middle name was Walking Death, was stricken with cancer. Kirby did not hesitate to step up and help in any way he could. He spent many hours driving Dickie to Seattle and back for alternative medicine, and things were not going well for him here. That was Kirby, willing to take time out of his busy life to help and friend in need. He truly was a class act. Anyway, it was simple to see Frank so vulnerable over the last few weeks and months of his life. That wasn't the Frank Kirby I come to know. It's unflappable and solid as a rock. That's the Kirby I will remember. One with a confident, unwavering presence. Lastly, every time I got to the mall, getting a really bad $10 haircut that comes without any decent conversation, I will think about Frank Kirby. And I will miss him a lot. I do very much hope that Frank can find solace in knowing that so very many people respect him and admire him for a life so well lived. Rest well, my friend.
Thanks, Frank.
Sorry for the echo.
The final speaker of this afternoon requires no introduction because it's me. I'm just going to talk about one more team that Frank sponsored. I mentioned earlier in the introductions that he and I worked together on a women's cross team, women's box lacrosse team. I got conned into coaching this team. It was one of those things, I'll coach for a couple of weeks if I can find somebody else. 4 years later, there we were, Frank and I, with this crazy bunch of women. Some of whom I carried on with and with the field across the years for another 7 or 8 years. I coached the team with Frank and everything else. He was our manager, our travel agent, because we did travel a fair amount. We traveled to Montreal, we traveled to Nova Scotia, a couple of trips to California just because we could. Unfortunately, we left the player behind in California once, but we won't delve into that. Since he can't defend himself, I'm going to blame Frank for that, even though it was my massive hangover that may have had something to do with it. He was our water boy, he was our gate man. Number one, he was our number one fan. That team was very successful. They had a very skilled group of players. They had a hard-working group of players. They won three national championships and three provincial championships in the 4 years that I was coaching the team with Frank. The manager and sponsor. But I think the most important thing, I'm sort of getting this drift that's gone through a lot of the speakers today, The most important thing is that the players were so incredibly dedicated. And I think the reason for their dedication was simply because they didn't want to let Frank down. Probably didn't care a lot of times about letting me down, but they did not want to let Frank down for all the things he did for them. There are a couple of examples of the incredible dedication. We had one young lady, use the term loosely, had the Kirby's logo tattooed on her left upper chest. And she would say to me, "Want to see my tattoo?" You're thinking she's going to do this. "Oh no, want to see my tattoo?" There was the Kirby's logo on her left breast. I believe she's here today, it's not a So if anybody's interested in seeing her tattoo, just up in this area here. We'll save that for later. We had another girl, and this is dedication, this is incredible dedication. She played, I believe it was softball. A lot of the girls played other sports during our season. We were making plans to go to Nationals in Montreal, and she had a softball commitment. I'm guessing it was provincials, given the time of the year it was. And her softball coach, a lot less easygoing and easy to get along with than I was, insisted that she make the softball trip. And she assured Frank and assured me that, no, she's going to Montreal with us. A few days before we're leaving, she shows up to practice for a plaster cast on her leg. Hip to ankle plaster cast. And I'm like, "Crap, what the hell happened to you?" "Oh, nothing. She actually got one of the other girls who was an art instructor at Langara College to put a cast on her leg. And that was the story she told her softball coach, that she broke her leg or torn her knee up or something. Couldn't make the softball provincials. And sure enough, I remember Frank and I walking from our cars to the airport to head for Montreal. There's two or three of the girls out on the sidewalk in front of YVR, cutting this cast off so she could get on the plane and make her way to Montreal with the rest of the team. Now that's dedication. But as I say, it seems to be a theme that runs through all the teams that he was involved with, whether it was auto racing, basketball, lacrosse, fastball, whatever. Nobody wanted to let Frank down because he would never want to let them down. That was Frank. Contacting in the background, but working his butt off nonstop to ensure that everybody else had not only a successful time, but a hell of a lot of fun. And I know we had a hell of a lot of fun with that swimming team. And I know hearing from the guys from the Steamers, from the Clippers, from the auto racing, and I know from all the other sports, those were two themes that went to teams that Frank sponsored. You had a hell of a lot of fun, and for the most part, you had a lot of success because you didn't want to let Frank down. Now, before we wrap up for the day, first of all, I'd like to thank all the speakers. I know it's tough. I've never done this before, to be honest with you. And it's not an easy thing to do, and I thank the speakers very much for doing a great job, for speaking of their respect and their love for Frank Kirby. I'd now just like to introduce Zaya. If you come forward and say a few words, Zaya.
That's all, Dave. Good echo. That's why you can't hear me. Can you guys actually hear me? So I'm going to open up a new business now, party planner. So this has been really, really difficult. You know, there's so much I could share about, as Lisa called him, our Frank. I met him at my work in 1984, working for Canis Press. Anyway, I was in charge of the committee. So the committees were the people that needed a program. So Frank being involved in baseball, he had a baseball program. And I had to attend to him and his changes for his program every week, along with a whole bunch of lacrosse programs. So anyway, we were doing 17, 18 programs every week. So of course, the boss that I worked for, Mitch Hannes, he kept telling Frank that my dad was rich. So I wasn't sure. So anyway, week after week, he asked me for lunch, to go out for lunch with him, and I was refused, only because he was twice my age. And of course, all the women there told me that he was a womanizer. Anyway, needless to say, we had a lot in common, despite the looks. We really did have a lot in common. So I did not write any speeches, just a whole bunch of little notes. And of course, this screen was supposed to be a little bit bigger, and I'm glad it's running throughout. There could have been over 1,000 photos. As you can see, there's a lot of photos up there. But anyway, I'm going to ramble on a little bit here. So just to touch up a little bit on what Lisa said, the Outrigger West, they had a French-Canadian bartender there, and he made the meanest Long Island iced tea. So if he knew you were going to Hawaii, Honolulu, or even if he booked you with the previous owners of Prestige Travel, that's how I got into it. I took over the agency. Anyway, before you got to Hawaii, he would call the bartender and he'd tell him that such and such is coming and to put the first Long Island iced tea on his tab. So before Frank even got to Honolulu, he owed the bartender anywhere from $50 to $100 just on complimentary Long Island iced tea. It is really hard to do this. One thing, I see a lot of people in the audience here, and of course I got a lot of texts and emails from people that are out of town, but if you met him and he forgot your name, the next time he called you, he named you Margaret or something else. And yes, our honeymoon days, our first trip after we got married was to Sturgis. I had never ever been camping in my life and never ever slept in a tent. So he went with the boys. The boys to Sturgis was always the funnest trip for him because it was that ride and the camaraderie. And I think I counted he went about 8 or 9 times. So anyway, the year 2000, we got married in February, and I flew in, he picked me up, and first time ever I slept in a tent, and that was the last time. Speaking about his legs every day, he had long, skinny, slim legs that any woman would die or kill to have. And then just so you all know, Frank and Fred have no tattoos whatsoever. No weight on their body. So it's a misconception that everybody has. And I just want to make sure you all know. Hugs, he did love hugs. Well, he liked hugs. But when he wore his glasses, when he see you, he would have to put his glasses on right away because the hugs from the women were so strong that they would crinkle up his glasses and he'd be all great. Anyway, when I know what I think or see or anything about marriage, it's always unique. Unique, unique, unique. He had Kirby's tattoo on everything that he did. So on the lacrosse sticks, on the shop, he had Kirby's on there. When he took over the team from Sewing Gill was looking for a sponsorship to pay for a fine that was incurred by Terry Richard. So he gave him $100 to pay off that fine. And when he got in, he basically took over. Everything had to have the K. So there's a lot of jerseys and fans there. We can probably start a lacrosse game here tonight. The boys against the women. Everything had Kirby's on it. It had to. So all his golf shirts, everything that he did after the fact at Kirby. So why am I saying that? His buddy Chum, Logan Gray, designed the first Kirby logo, and designed the second Kirby logo, and designed the third one finally. The third one, Frank had to have a set of knuckle rings with his name, Frank Kirby. And so many stories, just to let you know, his last count to Hawaii was 96. His original goal was 75, and I thought, oh great, this is trip 75, we can now start going to other places. That was not to be it, because the next goal was 100. We were in Mountain one year, and they just had installed this lift for handicapped people. So they would sit in this lift, and they would be brought down to the pool. So I said to Frank, if ever you get to that point, you will not be coming to Hawaii. So you better get your fill before you reach that stage. So we were planning a trip in September. So I will be taking that trip on with a friend, and his request was to spread some of his ashes in Hawaii. Our favorite spot that the last few years had been Maui. We have been to all the islands at least twice. So we've been to Lanai, we've been to Molokai, we've done them all. We've done two cruises around the island on Norwegian. So if you're interested, I'm still a travel agent. Yeah, Frank and I have been through a lot. And again, unique. We got married on a Tuesday night, February 29th, 5:30 at La Rustica restaurant with only 35 people there. And that's the way we wanted it, and that's what happened. I'd like to thank the speakers here today. I did choose them. And you know what? I probably should have said this earlier. If anybody has something quick they want to say, they can quickly make their way around here, and I will give them 5 minutes or a couple minutes if they'd like, because I know some people do like to speak and can speak, and I'm pretty sure still right now that Pam, Megan, and Aaron Lyons are still shaking their heads about Dad for ranting on here. They refuse to take him on an all-inclusive trip with them now. He makes friends with everybody. And then, yes, I can't remember. So a year ago, in June, I had an angiogram, and it was to be that I had to have open heart surgery. So I had 4 valve changes, and the date was set, it was September 1st, so 5 days before my surgery. Frank woke up, confused, in a daze, and did not know what was going on. So I quickly rushed him to Northumberland, and they found that he had had a stroke. So this was a Saturday. In a panic, calling his clients who he had for that day, and canceling their appointment. So Monday turned around and he had an MRI, and it showed that he did have a severe stroke. But it's a stroke that gave him no side effects, no paralysis. Sorry, I lied about the stroke. No paralysis. But the side effect was that he had lost his short-term memory. And he lost some of the sight where his driver's license was basically, they took it away. He had too many blind spots. So yeah, he had 14 things wrong with him. We had fixed 2 things in May, but at the end of the day, his lungs took out. He just stopped working. You know, when you smoke for 50 years, it's pretty hard to live a long life, but he did live a long and good life. He just escaped. Oh, yes. Everybody, try to find pictures to put a slide or anything. every single picture. He had a bloody cigarette in his hand. I could toss a cigarette in every single photo. Anyway, he did quit smoking 10 years ago, but it just wasn't good enough. So yeah, his short-term memory was one of the biggest things that caused him not to go out as much, or just be a little, he didn't participate in a lot of things. Anyway, the other thing about him being such a good barber, he just caught a rug a mile away. So if you're wearing a rug, it didn't matter how much money you paid, he knew it was a rug. You could never have that from him. And he loved when women had an awesome haircut, and he would tell you, like your haircut. The first thing he looked at was your hair, whether you had some or not. I can go on and on about him, about his life, about our life together. We did do some awesome trips because we were married. And on a leap year, we celebrated 2 days when it wasn't a leap year. We celebrated on the 28th and on the 1st. But when it was the leap year, our first leap year, we went to Vegas and caught the Celine Dion concert at Caesars. And we were, for some reason, we were coerced by Walt Davidson, I'm not sure if he's here, to go to Bakersfield to watch these drag races put on by the Good Boys, the Good Guys. Our second one, we went to Jamaica, we went to Sandals, and our last one, we went to the Cook Islands, not the Cook Islands, my brain is not working, it's been fried for the last month. Our last trip, big trip that was in Hawaii, was to Turks and Caicos, so we did enjoy our holidays together. Again, like everybody said, he did not have any mean bone in him, always pleasant. Didn't give up too much sentiment or feeling. I think that's good enough. We have still some food up in the room over there. There's drinks. I'll hang around. I'll put a little bit of everything up in that area. I have some decals. If you'd like a decal, come say hi to me and I'll give you a decal. We have also, if you want some of the photos, let me know, because it's a lot of stuff to take home. And like Lisa said, all those photos from the barbershop are all up here. And then we recycled many, because there's another photo underneath. I think that's all I want to say. Thank you all for coming. I'd like to thank all the speakers. Dave Evans, you're amazing. I can't think of anything else. I don't know if this mic will work up top. Maybe if you guys want to say a story or something, we could do that up top. Otherwise, thanks for coming.
Thanks, Simon. That's what I said. I came here last night just to get a good idea about the program. And I spent 2 hours just kind of not even making a dent on all the memorabilia and pictures and so forth that are up there on display. So please stick around, check that stuff out. I'm guessing 90% of you are going to find your picture in there somewhere. And be really, really embarrassed like I was when I saw some of mine. So please stick around. And most importantly, please stick around and share your memories with Frank Kirby. We lost a tremendous friend, and I asked him to stick around and spend time talking with the family and share your memories with Frank. Sorry.
So very quickly, you guys can put his name on every piece of clothing he had almost. We never liked anything to Sally Ann or Valley Village. We always went to a cousin, but some of them are too small for the cousin now. So I, in the room, I have some, but most of them are all polo shirts, because that's what he liked. So if you want a polo shirt, Kirby's on it, come see me in the room. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. So enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Thank you so much for coming. Bought the chance. There's a beautiful pink polo shirt up there with your name on it. Thanks very much for coming.